Good morning, everybody. We'll start in just a couple of moments, but I wanted to welcome you on this brisk March morning, and we'll get underway in just a couple of minutes, but I want to make sure everybody has a place to sit and that you're comfortable. And we have a great roster of speakers who have come from around the world and across the country to join us in this conversation today about the press and the presidency in the post-truth era. And I'd like to begin, if I may, this morning by introducing you to the Dean of the College of Journalism and Mass Communications here at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln. Dean Maria Marin is our host of this event and the one that helped to put it all together and with a great deal of diligence. So without further hesitation, let me please introduce our Dean, Maria Marin.
Well, thanks very much to Barney for that introduction. And I will echo his comments when he said, good morning, everybody, and welcome to what we hope is an inaugural conference on the press and the presidency in the post-truth era. In fact, we already have planned the next conference for Friday, November 10th, marking roughly the first anniversary of the election. We are delighted to have you here this morning, and particularly to have a wonderful slate of speakers to share their expertise with us. I want to extend special thanks to the college's staff for coordinating this conference, especially to Haley Hamill and Nicole Blackstone, who know how to make wishes come true, even at the last minute, and who planned for all the essential elements of this event. And I am ever so grateful to Nancy Waite, who handled all the logistics. Thank you to all of you. This event came about because we in the College of Journalism and Mass Communications believe in and uphold the values of the First Amendment. We cherish a free press as essential to democracy. And when I bantered with my colleague Rick Alloway, and we both had concerns about the election, about the press being under fire, about demagoguery replacing honest political discourse, and about values more consistent with those of a dictatorship than a democracy, we decided to host this conference. Obviously, news, real and fake, is now a regular topic of discussion. Fake news, according to Michael Shudson, the sociologist and media historian at Columbia University, is now far more prevalent than truthiness was a decade ago. He pointed out in an essay in Columbia Journalism Review this past week that news reporting has not existed in a full-bodied way for much more than a century. But at its best, he said, it has proved itself a bulwark for accountable democratic government and a thorn in the sides of autocrats around the world. Shudson talks about how the President of the United States is grabbing headlines with reckless assertions that he peddles to the public without evidence. A case in point were the allegations about Obama's tapping of Trump Tower this past weekend. And he points to various hallmarks of journalistic quality, namely the willingness to correct, retract, and apologize for misstatements in a timely manner, a reliance on professional ethics, including accuracy, an interest in contrary evidence, following the story regardless of its political implications, presenting multiple points of view, identifying sources whenever possible, using commonly accepted data and databases as evidence, and so forth. Peter Bale, who is the current president of the Global Editors Network, had this to say yesterday. The latest outrage is a burst of fake news direct from the source, the President of the United States asserting that his predecessor tapped his communications during last year's election campaign. He goes on to say, President Trump effectively has abused his office with an unprecedented and provably wrong claim about his predecessor. Even the much aligned head of the former head of the National Security Agency, James Clapper, has dismissed it. Yet it is just the latest in an almost daily series of head-spinning challenges to the principles of judgment, facts, and experience that typically underlie politics and journalism. Taking it further, he says that there are a number of factors at work in this crisis of truth, one of them being the disintermediation of the mass media that the Trump campaign achieved and that has persisted since he entered the Oval Office. And secondly, is the deliberate framing of the media as the enemy. He says it is a classic tactic of fascists down the years to accuse journalists of lies or bias, to repeat it often enough to unsettle them and sow doubt in the mind of the public. He says, I could scarcely believe even Trump could, as president, tweet, the fake news media is the enemy of the American people. Yet it is a pattern. Sow doubt, cast slurs, create a slogan, repeat, repeat, repeat. Carol Cadwallader in The Guardian a couple of weeks ago suggested that a company called Cambridge Analytica, which specializes in psychometric data and has 5,000 bits of individual data about 220 million American voters, is much behind the emphasis on fake news and the propaganda campaign currently going on. She says that the Russians have had the use of Cambridge Analytical type data and have declared that information warfare is where we are right now, and that much of Trump's support is coming from Robert Mercer, a multi-billionaire investment person, hedge fund manager and so on, who is the founder with Andrew Breitbart of Breitbart, and who in fact is funding much of the data, the big data that is being used in the current information warfare. So with those few thoughts, I will leave it open to the rest of our speakers, and we look forward to hearing everything that is going to be said this day. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Dean Merritt. And I will place this here. As our speakers come up today, there will be just a moment as I will attach them to this wireless microphone so you'll be able to hear them clearly. Can everyone in the back hear us okay? Great. Okay, just a couple of notes before we get going today. Our hashtag is PostTruthCOJMC, so if you're following the conversation and you're tweeting about it, that would be more than helpful, and we'd certainly urge you and encourage you to use that that hashtag. By the way, my name is Barney McCoy. I am a professor of journalism here in the college. I've been here for 11 years now. And again, we would like to welcome you on behalf of all the members of our college and joining us here this morning. I'd like to introduce our first guest, if I may, at this point. Also, one more note. I know we have a lot of students who are here as part of class discussions and assignments. And as you leave today, if you need to check off that as a credit for your class, let's see here. We'll have Haley in the back, just hands up in the air so you can check off with them. Nicole, thank you very much. So, all right, I think I've taken care of our primary business, so let's get down to the business at hand. And our first guest this morning is Mr. Nick Dawes, who is the Deputy Director for Media, Human Rights Watch in New York City. And his topic of conversation this morning is entitled The Demagogue's Playbook, Press Freedom, Accountability, and Post-Factual Populism. Just some background on Nick, who joins us this morning. He's the Deputy Executive Director, as I mentioned, for Media at Human Rights Watch. And he leads the organization's digital, multimedia, and external communications networking. Previously, Chief Content Officer at India's Hindustan Times, where he was responsible for a far-reaching digital transformation. Also, Editor-in-Chief at South Africa's leading political and investigative newspaper, The Mail and Guardian. So, Nick, please join us this morning. Let's give him a hearty round of applause. And by the way, Nick made it here. He made it through Chicago O'Hara, and I think that always is worthy of some mention. So, Nick, thank you very much for joining us. Okay.
Thanks so much for having me. It's really good to be here and for helping me to get through all of those airports on the way. So this is probably a little strange for many of you, because I work for a global human rights organization, not a news outlet, and not a university. I spent my journalism career in South Africa and in India. I have this slightly odd, hard-to-place accent. But here I am, talking about journalism and the U.S. presidency in Lincoln, Nebraska. Welcome to your new world, America. I think you're going to be hearing a lot more from people like me over the next 4 years. Because those of us who are from the global south, or from big but young and sometimes more fragile democracies, we've been listening to advice for the U.S., from the U.S., and following the example of the press in the U.S. for at least 70 years, maybe a little longer. But now we get a chance to talk back, and maybe also give back a little bit. But it's going to be weird. It's going to be weird for you. It's going to be weird for us. And a little concerning also. So, you know, I checked back over my mail on the way out here while I was preparing for this trip, and it turns out that it was on January the 24th that Dean Marin sent me a mail and invited me to join you out here today. And I think that date is quite significant because January 24th was the only the second working day of the post-truth era in American presidential history. And I think you have to credit your dean for being pretty quick out of the blocks. It was only 6 weeks ago, but it was probably the longest 6 weeks in U.S. media history, so it's worth kind of playing out the TikTok of those days again, I think. Or maybe not a TikTok, more of a kind of thump crash. Because it was on Friday the 20th of January that Donald Trump, with an assist from his two Stevens, Bannon and Miller, painted our television screens and our social media feeds red with American carnage. This extraordinary vision of a ravaged country that can only be redeemed by blood and the flag and strong leadership. Real hard nationalist language that would be familiar to people who work in my organization, perhaps more than familiar to people who work in the American press and the academy. The very next day he went to war with the press and also with the weather report at the CIA memorial. So the media were some of the most dishonest human beings on earth. And by the way, the sun came out while he was speaking. No, it hadn't. And I know that this seems kind of quaint now, right? Because we've gone from being just dishonest to being actual enemies of the people. But in the halcyon days of January, that kind of language was still pretty shocking. And a few hours later, Sean Spicer walked up to the podium in the White House and he opened up he had a pretty big gap between his shirt and his jacket, which apparently the president didn't like. But what yawned much wider was the credibility gap that he opened up in the course of that speech. He was making up crowd figures out of whole cloth, inventing metro ridership, and then stalking off without taking any questions. The next morning, Kellyanne Conway went on Chuck Todd's show. Chuck Todd is a pretty calm guy. She reduced him to spluttering incomprehension when she introduced him and the rest of us, and in fact the whole world, to alternative facts. So taking just one Monday to recover from that before sending out invitations for a conference like this is pretty impressive. And I think Dean Marin was quicker to recognize what was going on than a lot of people who were actually in the room when Sean Spicer's head exploded. The White House Correspondents Association, for example, was still insisting several weeks later that its annual dinner, this kind of love-in between the Washington power elite and the press, presided over by the president, was still going to go on just as normal. But clearly that weekend was a watershed. Before that Saturday, it was still possible, maybe a bit naive, but certainly possible, for people of good faith and rational disposition to think that Donald Trump's hostility to the press was just an electoral tactic, and it would give way to a more normal, maybe more colorful, but more normal mode of engagement. I think after that Sunday, only the craven and the blind could really fail to see what was going on, and I don't include the president's supporters in that category. Well, I include much of the opinion class in that category and a slice of the press. And I think maybe the reason Dean Marin was able to respond so quickly was that she, like some others, had seen the early warning signs of what was coming. And if you look at the press globally and if you've studied these trends globally, a lot of what was happening was very familiar. And certainly for those of us who've spent our professional lives in majoritarian or authoritarian populist systems, illiberal democracies, if you want to call them that, it wasn't surprising at all. But it certainly was strange to watch it play out in this country. And I can't really overstress how important it's been for those of us who do work in places where the institutions are thinner, to have the US as a strong example of press freedom and to see it so very, very quickly come under attack here, even if it was predictable based on what happened during the campaign, was a deeply strange and disturbing thing. So in these majoritarian systems or illiberal democracies, you still have elections and they're still decided, you know, to varying degrees, fairly in the sense that the numbers are accurately counted, but you have dominant party structures, you have weak institutions, you have autocratic leadership, and the press to varying degrees is free, but often under siege and often compromised. And I'm thinking about places like Turkey, Russia, Venezuela, in different ways, India and South Africa, where I've spent most of my time. These aren't dictatorships, but they're subject to the pressures of autocratic leadership and authoritarian populist style and the vagaries of living with weaker institutions and often a discredited press. So Donald Trump, for those of us who come from these places, was a very recognizable guy during the election, and we knew pretty much exactly what he would do because he told us what he would do. He told us throughout the campaign, he told us throughout the transition, and on his very first day in office, it's no accident that the first thing he did was to launch an attack on the press. This is the demagogue's playbook. I learned about how that works mostly in South Africa and in India. In India, you have an elected but hard nationalist leader. He is intensely Islamophobic. He prefers to talk to his followers on Twitter and post beautiful pictures of himself on Instagram than he does to take questions from the press. And he's been in power there since 2014. In South Africa, we experienced a great transition from apartheid to a robust constitutional, legislative, and regulatory system that really put in place the foundations for a strong and open press. We had a ruling party that seemed initially to be very committed to the whole accountability ecosystem that would grow up between the press, the courts, parliament, civil society, but that later became frustrated with what that actually felt like and what it looked like as it began to constrain power. And in both of these places, you ended up with very different kinds of leaders who wanted to represent themselves as the voice of the people. And to argue that their ability to deliver economic security, social and cultural security, physical security, had to supervene over the constitutional, institutional, democratic arrangements of the rule of law and an open society. So these kinds of leaders position accountability systems as obstacles, as things that get in their way of their ability to protect you and to serve you. And what they need to do in order to succeed in that regard is to displace and discredit other kinds of accountability system, other means of securing a good life, broadly defined, including economic security, physical security, cultural security. So I wrote a piece about this back in November, and I addressed to friends in the American press, and I think many of my friends in the American press thought it was a little over the top. A little extreme, a little heated, and I went through a few things in that piece that I thought would happen, and I'm going to go through the list again here, and maybe we can check off some of the things that have happened, some of the things that partially have happened, and some of the things that I think are still looming threats. Because while I think it's extraordinary, there are a lot of conversations like this happening across the country, and people are really beginning to grapple with what's going on, but I think there are still some outsized threats that aren't being dealt with. So the first thing in the demagogue's playbook is to start to choke off and change the conditions of access. Now, on one hand, that can mean, we're not going to do this kind of inside DC journalism thing where we trade little microscoops and we get favorable coverage in return and, you know, we get to hang out and we know how many almonds the president ate at night and we write nice profiles about that. Losing that is maybe not the end of the world, right? Losing the White House correspondence dinner is really probably not the end of the world. In fact, it's probably an unambiguously good thing. But there are other kinds of access, and those kinds of access include access to the building, access to officials, ability to ask hard questions at awkward times, ability to access information. In India, just after he came to power, Narendra Modi banned journalists from government offices, where they used to walk around as freely as if they were, you know, in their own buildings. He kicked them off the presidential plane. Today, Rex Tillerson is flying to Asia with no American journalists on his plane. And we'll have to pick up whatever happens there at a time of real crisis involving North Korea from the Chinese press, maybe from the Japanese press. No one's going to be able to organize a visa. No one's going to be able to get in there quickly enough. We know there's already been a situation in the White House where outlets perceived as hostile have been excluded from the press gaggle, the New York Times, CNN, the BBC, you know, other such strange and fringe outfits. So choking off of access has already begun to happen here. And it gets substituted for by this idea of direct communication. Twitter posts substitute for the back and forth of press conferences, officials stonewall legitimate inquiries, responsible journalists wait to publish because accuracy matters and right of reply matters. You end up not getting things out. So then you have to fall back on the law, freedom of information filings, investigative techniques. These things are again good, but they can be slow walked to the degree that real damage is done. One case I was involved in South Africa, we were trying to obtain a report that some South African judges had written on the theft of the 2003 election in Zimbabwe by Robert Mugabe. It took 7 years. We went through six courts, all the way up to the Constitutional Court, the equivalent of the Supreme Court, twice to the Supreme Court of Appeal before we won. By that time, it was 12 years after the election in question, you know, had taken place. So you have to cultivate other ways to get the data you need, and I think you can already start to see this happen in Washington. I bet if you look at the download data for Signal or for Confide and other encrypted chat apps, they're probably being downloaded in DC at a faster rate than they are anywhere in the world. And I'm sure the same is true in some state houses and other places. So access is one thing that changes deeply, and there's a whole journalistic model built around access which has deep problems, and which I think many of us would be happy to see consigned to the dustbin, but there's a side of access that's about the place of the press in the institutional architecture of democracy, that those seats in the White House, that briefing room, those seats in the State Department are a representation of that place, and to lose them is to lose that place. So it's very, very critical that people are able to defend against that. And as I say, we've seen the same elsewhere. The other more obvious tactic in the playbook is the one we heard about earlier, and that's the stigmatization of the press as opposition. This happened really, really fast here. You know, during the election, it was a bit about putting reporters in a pen and mocking them and treating them as a kind of stand-in for Beltway elites. But we went during the transition, we had paid protesters incited by the media. Then we had the failing New York Times. Then we had the opposition New York Times and Steve Bannon saying the press must just shut up. And then about a week later than that, we had enemies of the people, you know, language that goes back to Stalin. This is no longer just about a political strategy to identify yourself against elites. This is about attacking the basic accountability infrastructure of democracy. It's about asserting that any alternative framing of the facts to your narrative is partisan. So in South Africa, this was done by describing us as either members of the opposition or as CIA funded or as foreign capitalists. A member of parliament, I was once testifying in parliament in one of the, about a new intelligence law, really draconian law, almost as bad as your Espionage Act. And one of the MPs said to me, "Are you still a South African when you go home at night?" So that kind of language that associates accountability journalism with opposition is an absolutely standard piece of the playbook. In India, a phenomenon arose in the mid-2000s of political parties paying for news. So they would pay to have articles placed in the newspapers which represented their point of view, and they were disguised as news stories. It became a huge scandal. The press commission investigated, and this phenomenon called paid news, it was essentially the fake news of India 10 years before the fake news phenomenon here. And just like what's happened here, very, very quickly, that term, which was actually brought into public discourse by the mainstream press as part of their efforts to regain credibility, was used against them. So the Indian version of fake news is prestitutes or paid media, which are the standard terms of art by right-wing trolls in India. So all modern political leaders try to control the narrative. But for populists who are really promising sweeping change from below, that kind of spin isn't enough. They have to shape not only the story, they have to shape basic reality. And they do that in order to defang truth-based accountability systems. Criticism and discussion about how to cover this president tends to focus on the political side of that, of the association of the press with elites, of the failures of the press to pay attention to what's going on in working class communities in the heartland and so forth. But I think it's some of these structural dimensions that we're eventually going to have to turn our attention to. And those are getting a lot less attention in the discourse right now. Because the ultimate target of this kind of grandiose hostility to the press is not a particular political party or a political framework, it's the basic accountability architecture. No one who's covered an authoritarian system or an illiberal democracy would have been surprised when Trump segued from talking about the opposition media to talking about Judge James Robart of the Ninth Circuit and saying, the opinion of this so-called judge, which essentially takes law enforcement away from our country, is ridiculous and will be overturned. So the slippage from the opposition media to the so-called judge was very, very quick. Usually, in my experience, that takes a few years. It took about 2 weeks. And that's something not to be surprised about, but to be deeply concerned about. To come back to that weekend, the fight about facts centered on crowd size as a proxy for popularity. And that also wasn't an accident. Donald Trump's crowds have to be the biggest ever. His ratings have to be the best ever. Arnold Schwarzenegger has to be terrible. His favorability numbers, his audience metrics, his retweets. If he's anything but the biggest and the best on all the metrics, it feeds what Sean Spicer and Kellyanne Conway call a narrative of delegitimization of his presidency. Now, of course, that's not true. No one is really arguing that Donald Trump is not the legitimate president in the sense of electoral fraud. But the narrow legitimacy of an electoral college victory, of a popular vote defeat, increasingly of bad popularity numbers, of presidential authority hemmed in by courts, hemmed in by an active press, is not a sweeping mandate for revolution. And that's what he needs. So to lie performatively, to lie openly and get away with it, is to assert control over the facts. Lies used to end careers, now they sustain them. They vitiate accountability and create their own alternative logic of of legitimacy. And the challenge in the face of this as a journalist, because it's not something you can do a he said, she said story about anymore, the challenge in the face of all that is to maintain a tough, independent journalistic politics. That's a politics of accountability, equity, inclusion, a politics of laws and not men. These leaders are usually men. It doesn't mean aligning with the partisan opposition. That happened certainly very much in a place like Venezuela, where private media lined up closely behind the opposition because they thought that was the way to have the fight. And the result of that was that there was a real shrinkage of spaces for dissent and for accountability. So it's a very tough line to walk to articulate this robust, independent politics of journalism. And people actually on both sides of the divide want the press to fail at it. The president, for the reasons I've already outlined, the opposition party, because they can use all the help they can get. but it's absolutely critical to find a way to do that. So, choking off access, framing you as opposition. What else? When they can't regulate you away, and regulation is going to be very difficult in the US, we have such a robust First Amendment, they'll try to buy you out or suck up your oxygen. In many countries, this starts with a big attack on the public broadcaster. In the US, you don't really have a substantial public broadcaster. You, of course, have the Public Broadcast Corporation, which is already slated to lose its funding. But its place in the overall ecosystem is relatively limited. What you do have is crony billionaires lurking around the fringes of a distressed news industry. In India, for example, you've got hundreds of loss-making TV channels and newspapers, most of which are sustained purely for political purposes. In South Africa, the main English language daily group was brought out by a friend of the president and completely gutted. And closer to home, you can look maybe to Las Vegas, where you've already had a transaction where Sheldon Adelson, with his identity concealed, bought the primary newspaper in that town. You have Fox News acting pretty much like a state broadcaster right now. You have Breitbart taking up a place in the conversation which is vastly, vastly larger than you would ordinarily expect for an outlet like that. You have reporters from InfoWars starting to get accredited at government institutions. So if it doesn't work to buy out or target through lawsuits the mainstream publications, you give oxygen and space to the rest. And if you look at what the media ecosystem in demagogic countries looks like, you can see some very familiar stuff. So even before the election, many people in Europe were concerned with the information warfare complex that emanates from Russia, where you have glossy propaganda on Russia Today. You have Sputnik, which is a digital publishing outfit, offering all kinds of extraordinarily distorted, false disinformation, which is then redistributed very effectively, often using powerful data insights by armies of trolls and bots on social media. So if you look at the complex that's emerging in the US now, you have a large glossy network like Fox. You have digital insurgents like Breitbart and InfoWars. And if any of you tweet about this kind of stuff much, you'll notice how quickly you're found out by the armies of bots. Or if you discuss it in your Facebook feed, you'll see what kind of things get injected there. So I'm not saying that I have a prescription for how to fight that, but the playbook is very, very clear. The other thing that happens routinely in these scenarios is more litigation. Our experience in South Africa certainly was that initially this was done by proxy. So if we did tough investigative reporting on big donors, for example, or on corruption, the multimillionaire friends of the ruling party would take us to court. They never won. We never lost a single case, but they sucked up hours and hours and hours of our time. They sucked up millions and millions of dollars, which we should have been spending on reporting. So they vitiated our ability to do our work to a considerable extent. That's one thing if it happens to you and you're the Washington Post or the New York Times. If you're a smaller outlet, if you're a regional paper or a newspaper or a digital startup, the consequences can be much, much, much more crippling. The next step is worse, and that's when the proxies and friends and business cronies step aside and the security system comes to bear. Now, under President Obama, you already had the threat to prosecute someone like James Risen. The Espionage Act is a stunningly bad and anti-democratic piece of legislation that's still on your books here. We are already seeing an extraordinary amount of hysteria over leaks in DC. And I think the risk that this kind of legislation starts to be, it's been used against sources for years, but there's been this kind of friendly, if you like, gentleman's agreement that it won't be used against the press. I think we can agree that gentlemen's agreements with the press are over. Getting fingerprinted for journalism is a very, very strange experience. And I think that there's a very strong chance that that will be happening here soon. So you have a set of converging threats. There's a credibility threat, a trust threat, built on real problems in the journalism system that have been building up for years, but now weaponized out of the White House. You have a set of combined commercial and regulatory threats, which are also building up. And somewhere off the horizon a little bit, you have the risk of real legal and security threats. Now, there's been, as I said before, a really good discussion building up about what has to happen for the way, and I think there'll be a lot more of it today, for the way that we do our journalism in response to this environment. A discussion about whether to use the word lies, or to talk about falsehoods, or to talk about unsupported statements. A discussion about how to behave in the briefing room, about how to ask questions, about how much more important investigative journalism is going to be, perhaps, than it has been. But there's been much less discussion about these structural factors. And in my conversations with American reporters and editors, I'm struck by how deeply, deeply uncomfortable they are with a conversation about getting organized in the face of those threats. They say, well, we compete with each other. They say, we can't be seen by the public to be ganging up. They say, to organize practically in our own defense would actually make us into that opposition that you're talking about. And I understand that this feels very strange and very new. If you're used to thinking of yourself as part of the system, as part of power, if you're used to thinking of yourself as projecting a kind of Olympian neutrality and outsideness, even while you occupy this insider place, it's very strange to start to think of yourselves as political, not in the sense of party political, but in the sense that the basic work that you do is now being framed as political, in the sense that the basic place that you occupy constitutionally is being placed under political attack. And to respond to that, you have to have a theory about where you're being positioned from a power perspective, and you have to have an ability to respond. So I think there's going to have to be a discussion pretty soon. It's not a discussion for someone like me. It's a discussion for people in this room and people in American newsrooms about what it looks like to get organized and what you can organize around. And what can you organize around even if you have very different politics? What does Fox News care about as much as the New York Times cares about today? And I think those things exist. And I think those are the things that make up the basic building blocks of your ability to do your work. And those include the regulatory environment, the practice and culture environment, access to the briefing room, who gets accredited, who gets on the plane. They include the ability, particularly of smaller publications, to defend themselves against legal threats and to fund responses to those threats. And they include what everyone has to be concerned about around the dimensions of national security reporting and the potential for prosecutions in that area. So I think publishers, media freedom lawyers, academics, and others have to get together and articulate a platform that's about defending the information infrastructure of democracy. Separately from the debate about fake news, separately from the debate about lies, a debate about infrastructure. There's a huge amount to be encouraged by in what's going on right now. And there's great work going on at the Times, there's great work going on at the Post, there's great work going on at BuzzFeed. Brian Stelter is going on the TV every Sunday and teaching a huge swathe of the country media literacy. But without this kind of organization, I'm really worried that that won't be enough. And I'll just make one last suggestion before I stop, and maybe we can have a bit of a conversation, and that is that our experience in South Africa when we began to try and organize against robust intelligence legislation was that just like here, we lacked a lot of political credibility. People thought it was special pleading and that we were demanding different treatment from everybody else. It was only when we allied ourselves as journalists with community organizations who want to defend their right of access to clean water, who He wanted to be able to call out a corrupt counselor. He wanted to be able to make those linkages between transparency and accountability and the health of the public sphere, that we were able to get a different kind of hearing. So anyway, when I was sitting and testifying in Parliament in a suit, and I did wear a tie that day, and people were protesting outside the gates from poor communities, that we were able to get a different kind of hearing. These are very, very strange things to think about for American journalism, I know, but these are very, very strange times. Thank you.
Thank you. Nick Dawes from Human Rights Watch, and questions from the audience. I'd be more than happy. We have a few minutes to circulate in the back. I'm going to come to you, sir, and we'll take your question.
Are the ills that you've laid out more likely to be prevalent in countries that have either multi-political party systems or parliamentary systems or both?
I think that they can happen in both. The question is, they can build up in places where the system becomes really unbalanced and where either the dominant party, so in the South African case, you didn't have a super charismatic demagogic leader in Jacob Zuma, you have a party majoritarian. And so he will argue that people voted for the African National Congress in large numbers, won 60%, and that is the beginning and end of democracy. After that, you listen to us. So it's an understanding of democracy that says the courts, the press, the civil society, and other institutions of a living democracy, parliament, everything that makes it work in the years between elections, has to essentially subject itself to that popular mandate. And that popular mandate is the only thing that can deliver. In a place like Russia, you know, it's much more a question of an authoritarian leader, or Turkey, an authoritarian leader himself proclaiming that his leadership, in Venezuela as well, that his leadership is what's going to deliver for the people, and that other democratic checks and balances are an obstacle. So I think it can happen in parliamentary systems, it can happen in executive systems. It's more likely to happen probably in places where more authority is concentrated in the presidency. But I think it can happen in a range of systems where these things get out of balance and where an illiberal approach to democracy prevails. And it's almost harder to respond to in those settings because you think, well, we have elections, we have courts, we have laws that protect press freedom, but a sort of series of attacks on multiple fronts begins to weaken all of that, and the whole system becomes compromised.
Other question from the audience. Any other questions? Professor Sue Bullard.
Is there a risk from the press focusing too much on how he's treating us? Oh my gosh, he's not coming to the correspondents' dinner. Is that going to backfire instead of focusing on what he's doing with policy?
I think you have to do both. I mean, there is a real risk that people see us as kind of whiny and entitled, and you know, a lot depends on how we have that conversation. And that's why I actually think Brian Stelter is doing quite a good job on a Sunday, right? Every day he's trying to reframe that conversation and say, press freedom is actually about accountability systems, and it's about everybody's rights. And I think it's very important not to fall into the trap of moaning about things that people feel like that people feel are unfair entitlements in the first place. I mean, as a foreigner, watching the White House Correspondents' Dinner on TV over the years, frankly, makes me feel mildly ill. I think it was extremely damaging. Extremely, extremely damaging phenomenon. And I think it was illustrative of exactly the kind of influence complex that has made it so easy for Donald Trump to do what he's done over the last few months. So I think we have to avoid that framing that what we're trying to maintain is a privileged place within the power system. We have to be able to show people that we're on their side. Not that we're on the side of their political party, but we're on the side of their interests. And I think it's critical that we cover these attacks on democracy rather than these attacks on us as individual representatives of the press. And then at the same time, we have to bang away very hard at the investigative work and the accountability work and the work around what he's really doing. Although I would say one thing people often ask, should we cover the tweets, that kind of thing? Everything the president says is an act and a use of power. So there's no getting away from covering that.
Another question. Yes, sir.
Thank you. What role have you seen the minority parties in your examples, like in India and South Africa, play? And how should the minority parties here respond to like that?
That's a great question. They can play a good role and they can play a bad role. The good role is when they take advantage of the institutions that are there to help usher information into the public domain and to keep open the speech space and the conversational space. So, in Parliament, for example, in both India and South Africa, the opposition parties are quite effective at using Parliament as a domain of information contestation. They'll ask a question that's designed to force certain information into the public domain. They use those kinds of platforms quite well, and I think that's really, really critical. In my own career as a reporter, I spent about 6 years in Parliament, and it was an extraordinary funnel of information. And you could find all kinds of stuff there that was being neglected, and opposition parties, minority parties could do very well in helping that to get out. What they do that's less effective is to try and co-opt media into a political opposition project, which, as I said, feeds the delegitimization narrative.
We have time for one more question from our audience. Over here, yes, sir. I'll walk over to you.
Thank you. You mentioned hesitancy on the part of a lot of the editors that you spoke with at newspapers. What do you think it's going to take to change that hesitancy into action? And what would, I don't know if this term is correct, this new form of journalism, this new form of cooperating with each other, what is that going to look like?
So people whom I've spoken to, initially they said that it was unthinkable to have any kind of practical formation together. And I mean, I was talking about things like, open an office in DC, hire 4 or 5 people, start to possibly think about pooling funds for litigation or risk insurance for litigation. Those kinds of things. No one would argue that Dow Chemical and Bayer AG have exactly the same interests. No one would argue, however, that they shouldn't both try and ensure that there's a regulatory environment in which they can participate in the chemicals business successfully and rip each other's throats out competitively. So in my earliest conversations about this stuff with editors and media people in this country a few months back, they said that they really couldn't ever imagine doing something like that. Now some of them are starting to say, well, yes, maybe we will need to, but we need a precipitating event. Now, if getting excluded from the gaggle is not a precipitating event, if getting described as the enemies of the people and getting told to shut up is not a precipitating event, I'm not sure what it's going to take. We talked a lot in South Africa. This change happened more slowly. We all believed strongly in the new government, in the project of democratization. And as they slowly lost patience with us and started to turn the screws, they moved us out of the main building in Parliament. They tried to introduce statutory regulation of the press. As these things slowly started to ratchet up, we had to realize that we talked about being, the proverbial frog in the hot water. Not noticing that the temperature was building and building and building until we were, frankly, boiled. So I think people are still waiting for some further grand event. I'm not sure that it's going to come as a grand event. It's, death by a thousand cuts, but they're coming very fast. The collaboration that I'm talking about is at that level. Collaborative journalism, for example, in the sense of the consortium for investigative reporters and working across titles is a whole other discussion, and I think it's a great one to have. How, for example, could a newsroom in a regional center like this work with a national newsroom on an investigative project? How can people work across media, you know, across broadcast and digital, for example? People who have statehouse correspondents or correspondents in small towns work with national outlets who've lost some of that reporting capacity. That's a whole discussion in itself. I think it's really important. And I think in this debate, which I'm sure will come up here today, about how the press in, you know, away from DC and New York responds to these things, I think it's important there. And I think it's also important to cover the international dimensions of a president whose business interests apparently stretch from China to Azerbaijan to the Philippines. So perhaps there's scope for collaboration internationally as well. Journalists are not great at collaboration because we want to own all the stuff ourselves. But again, it's a strange time. We've got to learn new things.
Thank you again. Nick Dawes this morning from Human Rights Watch in New York City.
Thank you, sir.
All right, let's take a quick five-minute break, and we will be back with Professor Gary Kebble. He'll be talking about the role of the media and politics in a social and mobile media world. We'll be right back.